name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The readings for the second Sunday in Advent from the Epistle, St. Paul's letter to the Romans. Brethren, whatever thing have been written for our instruction, that through the patience and the consolation afforded by the Scriptures, we may have hope. May then the God of patience and of comfort grant you to be of one mind towards one another according to Jesus Christ, that one in spirit you may with one mouth glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore, receive one another even as Christ has received you to the honor of God. For I say that Christ Jesus has been a minister of the circumcision in order to show God's fidelity in confirming the promises made to our fathers, but that the Gentiles glorify God because of his mercy, as it is written. Therefore will I praise thee among the Gentiles and will sing to thy name. And again he says, rejoice, you Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and sing his praises, all you peoples. And again, Isaiah says, there shall be the root of Jesse, and he who shall arise to rule the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. Now, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope and in the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Gospel is from St. Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. At that time, when John had heard in prison of the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples to say to him, art thou he who is to come, or shall we look for another? And Jesus answering said to them, go and report to John what you have heard and seen. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead rise, the poor have the gospel preached to them, and blessed is he who is not scandalized in me. Then, as these went away, Jesus began to say to the crowds concerning John, what did you go out to the desert to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Behold, those who wear soft garments are in the houses of kings. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, who shall make ready the way before thee. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. By the words of the Gospel, may our sins be taken away. Amen. Okay, dear friends, here we are in the second week of Advent, and I'm happy to report that I got some feedback. I always get a little bit of feedback on my homilies, but especially on this last one, and it led me into discernment and reflection on this week. And when I started to think about it, I wanted to make sure that it wasn't my desire, you know, something I wanted to talk about. As you know, one of my desires and promises I made to our Lord as a priest is to always use his Holy Scripture. And so we have this for us, before us again, the second week of Advent. And I found it amazingly interesting, the readings, because they fit. And what came to mind was, based on last week, because remember last week I said that modern Catholics and the modern church expect Santa Claus at Advent. And boy, as we say down south, boy howdy, do they. And I think we all do to a degree. You know, in talking with a few people and getting some feedback and just having a little more dialogue about this, not dialogue about that I'm wrong, because I'm not, I'm correct, and you know that, but dialogue about why. What can we do? And then we have these readings. And St. Paul comes to us, once again, speaking to the Romans, and he's talking about the two factions. You know, he's talking, and in this particular case, he's talking about the Jews and the Gentiles. The Jews who have recognized our Lord as the Messiah, as Christ, as the one who was and who is to come, and who has come, and who are learning and becoming strengthened in the faith through him, the crucified one. Okay, and then there are the Gentiles who have, maybe in a way that we would understand in modern terminology, who've gone in head first, all in. They don't have the baggage of the law, of Judaism, of all that they followed. They've been able to go in head first, and they have found a lot of, can we say success? Because that's what happens when you give complete trust to our Lord. And that's what St. Paul is reminding his Jewish brethren, in that Holy Scripture had already predicted this, that the Gentiles would hope and be ruled by this Messiah. That's how they would see them. And the Jews would have to come around to recognize who the Messiah is. So he's saying to them, we find our hope and our grace and our love and everything that we are right here in Holy Scripture. Don't be too hard on one another. Give each other some space, give each other some time, but also support and love, because we're all heading the one direction. But there is one truth, that which we have received from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So very interesting, because in the church today, we have, maybe we can say, you know, at least from my perspective as a traditionalist, and then we have those who are, who maybe are followers of traditionalism. They go to, they'll go to Latin Mass once a month, a couple times a month, maybe even every week, but their life is not surrounded by that which the church always taught, always believed by everyone everywhere. The catechism of Holy Scripture, of what the church came to believe over the centuries and developed into the catechism that was once taught to everyone and then was abandoned, beginning with the Vatican councils. Vatican I, and then, of course, Vatican II. And so there's this inconvenient truth, because the truth is that Advent is a penitential season, as our Lord keeps reminding us in the prayers, stir up in us, O Lord, that which you pull, which you excite in us, which is a desire to be close to you. That's what Advent is the Advent of our Lord coming in his incarnation. But our hope is in knowing that he is the crucified one, and he has, and in that crucifixion, in his passion, death, and resurrection, he has wrought for us all that is necessary for our salvation. And so let's quickly move in to the Holy Gospel from St. Matthew, because here we have the wonderful, the beautiful St. John the Baptist, who's in prison, who's already been taken up by Herod, and now hears of the Messiah and sends his own disciples and says, are you the one whom we should be looking for? And our Lord responds, says, look with your eyes, hear with your ears, you can smell it in the air. Everything that Holy Scripture has said and prophesied for 4,000 years is right before you. And blessed is he who is not scandalized in me. Because he's prophesying. Because they would all be scandalized at him. Everybody that was there before him, because no one except for his mother and then St. John the Apostle, who would be there, and St. Mary Magdalene, who would be there at the foot of the cross, at least officially that we recognize. There probably were a few more, but from Holy Scripture, that's what we see. And so that's why he says, blessed are those who aren't scandalized in me. Because right now, you see the miracles. You have the feelings. If the truth is not inconvenient for you right now, but it's going to be inconvenient when they come to get me for speaking the truth, for being the truth, and they crucify me. Then will you still be by my side. That's what he's saying to us. That's he's prophesying for all of us. And he's looking at St. John, and he says to them, what did you expect to find going out to the desert? Did you think you were going to go out there? Because remember, they're looking for miracles. That's what they're going out. They're saying, oh, this guy's healing. Oh, this guy's doing this. This guy's, I'm going to go. Just like now. It's like if someone says that they're seeing the Blessed Virgin Mary, or if they're having some sort of miracle, you're always going to find people who are willing to go. That's why it's very, very important that we keep those things to ourselves. As St. John the Cross teaches about these types of things, and I've had videos on this, on discerning these types of things, if God desires for the public to know something that he's given specifically to you, he will make it known. You don't have to do it. It's something for you. But I don't want to digress too much into that, because we're talking about the second week of Advent. The difference about this penitential season is that it goes very quickly, because next week we're already moving into the third Sunday of Advent, which you'll see the rose vestments. And yeah, we'll be talking even more about the great hope, the great expectation, the great love, the great desire. Because remember, what we are being reminded of this week is to be patient and to be tolerant of the other, of maybe the weaker, because we should stand fast in the truth. Because although the truth may be inconvenient, because we do hold the truth, don't think that we don't. Traditionalists do hold the truth, especially those like myself, who have not set up these alternative hierarchies, because that's something that the old Romans have not done, as maybe some other groups haven't done publicly, but privately they kind of, you know, they don't recognize the Pope. And so once you don't recognize the Pope, you know, I mean, we've had bad popes before, we've had very bad popes, we've had very sinful popes before. But, you know, they're still, at least canonically, it's still, and I know there's a lot of disagreement on that, but that's the truth. And so we stay steadfast in the truth. That's what St. Paul reminds the Romans, to be patient with the other, that may be a little weaker, but to remember to stay with the truth. And here's a little tidbit. Someone like me, who was ordained properly, under the proper traditional requirements that all priests have been ordained since before Vatican II. Since 1968, when they changed the ritual, that every bishop and priest ordained after that time, you have to at least question. And there are some of us who will say, you're ordained, but you're not an ordained Roman Catholic priest. You're an ordained minister of something, but you're not an ordained Roman Catholic priest. Okay, here's a tidbit about the truth. Because someone like me can pick up a missal from 500 years ago, from 1,000 years ago, from 200 years ago, from anywhere around the world, for the Roman Rite, and I can use it. Right now. I have no problem using it. Neither would any of our bishops, either of our bishops, or any of our priests that I know of, even though we're few. Why is that? Because we stuck to the truth. The truth has not been inconvenient for us. It has caused a lot of, we have to be without. Because believe me, when you stand for the truth, when you remain steadfast, for certain, you will have opportunity to determine whether you're going to be scandalized or not. Blessed is he, says our Lord, blessed is he who is not scandalized in me, and I am not scandalized by the crucified one. And I, along with my brethren, the old Romans, and all those of the lay people who follow the old Romans around the world, stand steadfast in our faith, and we stand steadfast ready to help and to honor our brethren who are learning, who may still be going to the modernist church, who may still be doing modernist things, but look over and say, they need to get better. And so this Advent, reach out. Reach out to your neighbor. They're still Catholics. They're still our brethren. They may have fallen for the falsehoods and the innovations of the modern church, but that doesn't mean that they aren't searching and desiring, because the Good Shepherd is also searching and desiring. He's going to use you and he's going to use me to get to them. And in the second week of Advent, let's stay steadfast. Let's stay upright. Let's stay willing to say to these people, keep coming, keep learning. Don't give up. I'll help you. Remain in hope. Remain in love. Remain in truth, because the truth is never inconvenient. The truth will always bring you the grace and love of our Lord Jesus Christ, and you will never be scandalized in him, and he will never be scandalized in you. God bless you, and God love you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.